You are watching the official worship cast of Journey of Life Church in Orlando, Florida. Visit us on the internet at journeyoflife.org.
Good morning. Good morning. Let's take a moment as we go. Father, we are here this morning. We acknowledge your presence. We trust in your love. We ask you to draw us to yourself today. Teach us, lead us, strengthen us, comfort us. Do your good work in us, because we know whatever you want to do in us is what needs to happen in us, because we trust your love and kindness, powerful goodness, because it's been put on display in the person and work of Jesus Christ, his life, death, and resurrection. And so now we begin the service looking to you in Jesus' name. Let's stand it.
Thank you. And the setting for this is that, if you remember, the nation of Israel is an occupied territory. The Romans are in charge of Israel. Rome actually has a garrison in the temple. Pilate has a palace in Jerusalem. There are Roman soldiers walking the streets of Jerusalem. And the Israelites always saw themselves as God's people who will never be enslaved. And so that's kind of what's going on here as the Pharisees try to entrap Jesus, because they don't like what he's teaching. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle him in his talk. And they sent to him their disciple with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are true, and you teach the way of God in truth, nor do you care about anyone, because you do not regard the praise of men. So tell us, therefore, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" Jesus perceived their wickedness, and he said to them, "Why do you test me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." So they brought him a denarius, and he said to them, "Whose image and inscription is this?" And they said to Jesus, "It's Caesar's." And so Jesus said to them, "Render therefore to Caesar's what is Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And when they had heard these things, they marveled, and they left him and went their way. Just a reminder, before we begin the message, to take a moment to fill out that green card. It's got the prayer requests on the back side, where you can check the little box that says whether we can pray for it out loud, and also whether or not we should add to the prayer newsletter, and then fill out the other side, of course, just so you know it's here and you want to be good stewards. So let's take a moment and pray. Father in heaven, you have brought us here together today, and we desire to hear from you. We desire to learn from you. And so we ask that your Spirit teach us through your word what it means to be good citizens of the country in which we live. We want to thank you for the opportunity to study your word together. In Jesus' name. So, you know, the Wednesday Bible study has been going through hell. Not literally, hopefully, anyways. It depends on how bad my teaching is on any given day. But we've been going through hell, the doctrine, the teaching of hell. And I sent out an email yesterday that said, "We're going to do it. we're going to talk about politics in church tomorrow. And somebody emailed me back and said, so it's going to be hell on Wednesday and Sunday now. Very, very witty. So, but we are going to talk about politics and how to think about politics today, just a little bit for a few minutes. We want to be, of course, we love our country, well, most of us do anyways, and we love our Lord. And so we want to be good followers of Christ, and we want to be good citizens of this country. That I think, this is the only thing I'm going to offer you my own opinion on. I think that our country is founded on very Christian principles, the main one being the freedom of the individual. Because God doesn't come to us to force us to submit to Him. He comes to us in love and offers us the freedom to receive or reject His offer of love and forgiveness. So I think that the freedom of the individual is a thing in the Bible, and I think our country is founded on the freedom of the individual. And I like that. But that being said, that's the last opinion I'm going to give you, because my job here is not to teach about politics, but to teach about the Bible. So the first thing we need to know is that the forms of government and social structures really didn't seem to concern the biblical writers a whole lot. Paul was a Roman citizen. He only used that when it was to his advantage. And frankly, it actually doesn't make much difference to us, because Rome was a republic for about 450 years or so, but Rome finally lost their republic in 27 BC, 27 years before Christ. The formal form of Rome switched from a republic to an empire. And then the Caesar, the leadership was passed down, father to son, or whoever could wrestle power from the leader. So Paul's citizenship in Rome, by the time Jesus is alive and beyond, is not going to help us at all. Well, it'll help us very little anyways, understanding. So there's another thing. There's a book in the Bible called Philemon. Anybody ever read the book of Philemon? Doesn't take very long, does it? It's a letter. It's a letter to a man named Philemon, who had a slave named Onesimus. And wouldn't you know it, Paul was good friends with Philemon, and then he's in another place in prison, and he's preaching, teaching, and talking to people, and this guy named Onesimus comes to Christ and comes to faith, and he confesses to Paul and says, you know what, I need to confess this, and I'm a runaway slave. And, you know, you can picture it in mind. Paul says, well, you know, where'd you run from? Whose slave were you? And he says, it was a guy named Philemon back in, you know, that other city. And Paul's like, I know Philemon. And what do you think Paul did? He said, you got to go back. Onesimus, you got to go back, because you ran away. He didn't take the opportunity to denigrate the institution of slavery or anything like that. We're not going to go there today, but what I'm pointing out to you is that the earthly institution that put Onesimus as Philemon's servant was not Paul's primary concern. It was the heart of Philemon and the heart of Onesimus that was Paul's primary concern. And then, of course, we have what we just read. Was should we pay taxes to Caesar? And Caesar, remember, Caesar's not, in the Israeli view, he's not the legitimate authority, because they are an occupying foreign force. And the people come and ask if you should pay your taxes to Caesar or not. And Jesus basically says, yeah. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. And in case you missed that, what's really going on there is whose image and inscription is on the coin, so that's Caesar's. Whose image and inscription is on you, God's. So when he says, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, or God's what is God's, he's saying, well, if you look in the mirror, you see the image of God on you. And so you need to give your whole self to God. Don't worry, just pay the taxes. So we have all these situations that seem pretty strong to us, foreign occupiers, slavery and stuff, but they really don't take the opportunity to address those things as social structures directly. So we want to talk as Christians today. And what we know as Christians is that our job never changes. Only the environment in which we do our job. You and I have job number one, is to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And that the way that expresses itself changes based on the environment. But your job never changes. It's to be a follower of Christ. It's to exhibit things like this: to be loving and joyful and peaceful and long-suffering, to be kind and good and faithful and gentle and have self-control. That's the way we live. Whether we're in a democracy or whether we're in something else, whether we like the president or whether we dislike the president, whether we like the last president or dislike the last president, we still live as followers of Jesus Christ, including governments we disagree with. And this actually did come up. Whoops. Yep. Including the way we relate to the government. Titus 3 verses 1 to 2, remind them to be submissive to the rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, and to show perfect courtesy toward all people. I might make that my Facebook header. See if I can change the internet world a little bit. So, but the bigger thing is here, we have the reminder to be submissive to the rulers and authorities. Peter also says the same thing. Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good, you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the emperor. Honor the emperor. Why? Why would we do this? Why would Paul send Onesimus back to Philemon? Why would Jesus say, pay the taxes to the occupying forces? Why would we be told to be submissive and courteous in all things? Why are we supposed to honor the emperor? The emperor? We're Americans. The reason is because our job is the same in all circumstances, all places, and all times. The soul is the first concern. People are brought to Christ through love, not power. People are won over by kindness, not coercion. And so if our first job is to be followers of Christ, then our mode is going to be kindness, love, and compassion, and concern. But it's not a mushy, wimpy, submissive kind of, like, it's not agreeing with whatever people say, but it's refusing to repay evil for evil. It's refusing to resort to deception. It's refusing to resort to violence. So we are called to have a strong love as citizens of our country and citizens of whatever country we find ourselves. Now, we've talked about our first job, to be followers of Christ, to be the bringers of God's love and compassion and new life in Jesus Christ, regardless of what circumstance we're in. That's definitely our first job. However, we happen to live in a country where it's government of, by, and for the people, right? At least that's the ideal. That's the ideal set forth in our founding documents, to be a government that is a people who are self-governing. And that's a privilege, right? So while there's no instructions on the Bible directly regarding governmental forms and social structures and stuff, there certainly is a great deal of talk about what a person with power should do with their power. And what power do you have? The voice and the vote. In the United States, we have the power of the voice and the vote. And so we still, even though the forms and government and stuff aren't specifically listed, we still have to ask ourselves, as followers of Jesus, how do we use power? How do we use the power that we have to serve Christ in the world? Because that's the power we have. You can choose to support whatever form of government and policy you want, but what you cannot choose as a Christian is whether or not to care about other people. You remember the parable of the sheep and the goats, where the king is sitting on the throne and he sends one to the sheep to one side and the goats to the other, And the thing that sends them to the one side or the other are whether they clothed the naked, whether they took care of people in prison and all this stuff. And so as we express the power of our Christian citizenship, that's what we need to be thinking about, because we aren't free to not care about other people. Scriptures make it very clear that God's call is for His people to do things like to seek justice and mercy, to feed the poor, to clothe the naked, to fight for the rights of people who are being oppressed and downtrodden, the rights of the powerless. Micah 6, verse 8, familiar verse to most of you. He has shown you, O man, what's good. What does the Lord require of you? To do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And of course, that's to you, and to you, and to you, and to you, and to me. But each of us is a citizen of this country, and so as having the power of voice and vote, now we have to ask ourselves, what does following Christ look like for citizens who have the power of voice and vote? What does that look like? How do we serve God? Because especially the later prophets make it very clear that if you think the serving of God is in the ceremonies, you have missed the point. If you think serving of God is... Church is a great place to learn and grow, but if you don't... If it doesn't change your life to listen to the Word, then that's something that you need to think differently about. Because, Isaiah, he made it clear. This is Isaiah talking to, the voice of God talking to the people of Israel. You humble yourselves by going through motions of penance, bowing your heads like reeds bending in the wind. You dress in burlap and cover yourself with ashes. These are all like things of fasting and repentance, right? Is this what you call fasting? Do you really think that will please the Lord? No. This is the kind of fasting I want. Free those who are wrongly imprisoned. Lighten the burden of those who work for you. Let the oppressed go free. Remove the chains that bind the people. Share your food with the hungry. Give shelter to the homeless. Give clothes to those who need them. And do not hide from your needy relatives. That's what I get. Just a little tag on the end. Don't hide from your relatives who need your help.
Okay.
But so you and I, we are Christians. And we are citizens of America, so we have the power of the voice and the vote. We live in a country where we select our leaders, which is a great privilege. And that's where we have to start talking about politics. Politics. Does everybody like to start with dinner company? Just because I said the word politics in church. So, the word politics comes from a Greek word polis, which means city. So it has to do with how people in any group or city organize themselves. So it's really not a bad word in its root. It's how people are going to city ourselves, or state ourselves, or country ourselves, or whatever like that, right? So the question I want to answer for you, not answer definitively, but give you some ways to think through, is how to talk about political issues. Because if you are a Christian, and you have a call to do all those things we just read, and you have some power, the power of voice and vote, you need to learn how to talk about these things. Otherwise, you're not using your power of voice and vote to be a servant of Christ in the world in one way that you could. So, what do we do here? How do we do this? I got six. I should have had seven ways, but maybe six is an appropriate number for politics.
Yes.
Were you the only one? Okay, so how to talk about political issues. Number one, here's what I think you have to do. I think you have to expose yourself to a wide variety of ideas. I think that you have to listen to other people and think through what they are saying about different issues. And I have the Bible to back me up, which you believe. Proverbs 18, verse 13, if one gives an answer before he hears, it is his folly and shame. So you have to listen to other people. Proverbs 18, verse 15, an intelligent heart acquires knowledge. The ear of the wise seeks knowledge. So you've got to listen to other people. You've got to find out why they think what they think. What's behind that? The one who states his case first seems right until the other one comes in and examines him. So that's that give and take, that iron sharpens iron that goes on. And unless we learn how to talk politics instead of argue politics, then this thing can't take place. Because there won't be that there won't be that cross-pollination of ideas and thoughts that come in from the outside to help us. And we all need them. You know what happens if there's a very small gene pool, right? If a few people interbreed, what happens there? Lots of weird birth defects, right? That's probably what happened in the royal line in England, is they just interbred with too few people and they started to go crazy. Because that's what happens if you don't have a broad gene pool. Well, there's this word meme. And you know, a gene is a bit of information carried in your cell, right? So a meme is an idea, a bit of information carried in your mind. And I'm going to give credit where credit is due. I don't agree with a lot of what he says, but this guy, Richard Dawkins, who is an atheist, is the one who came up with the word meme, because he saw that ideas seem to jump from one person to another, and mutate a little bit too, as they go. And so he coined this word meme. But what I would like to tell you is that your meme pool needs as much diversity for your health as your gene pool. If you don't expose yourself to other ideas and ways of thinking and looking at things and other just plain old data about, if you don't take the time to understand what's really going on, even before you get to ideas, then you're going to have a very unhealthy mind. You're not going to have a healthy enough mind and viewpoint to think about and use your power as a Christian citizen for voice and vote wisely and correctly. And so that's the first thing. You gotta expose yourself to a wide variety of ideas to increase your, to broaden your meme pool. Read articles that, not just articles that you go, yeah, 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 but articles that you disagree with. Articles that make you uncomfortable and edgy because you don't really like what they're saying, but it just, I'm starting to feel like you might have a point. Those are articles that you should be reading. Is healthcare a human rights issue? If so, then what about the doctor's right to decide what to do with his own life and who to treat? Is healthcare an issue of societal responsibility to care for the poor? That's a different question. Then maybe it's the responsibility of the doctor who's been trained in everything that exists in our society to help other people. Because we would say it's the responsibility of the powerful to help the powerless. Maybe we would as a society. I'm kind of a, I don't know what kind of person I am, but I like to engage people on Facebook and try to keep the discussion lively and kind and knowledge-based. And so I got in this discussion about universal health care, and a guy from Sweden, what I mentioned was why should somebody who makes the effort to take good care of their health pay for people who don't do anything like that and don't take care of their health at all? And he said back to me, why should I pay for the health care for a bunch of health nuts who constantly need knees replaced and hips replaced and they break bones skiing and they tear their rotator cuff because they're lifting weights? Why should I pay for them? But you know what? That's actually a good point. People do get injured when they're trying to be healthy too. Open my mind a little bit to think about things. It was good for my meme pool. So, that's the first thing. You gotta expose yourself to other people's ideas and not just the bullet points, but understand why they think what they think. Because most people aren't crazy. Most people aren't. And they've got good reasons. If you can keep calm enough, talk long enough, they've got good reasons for why they think. Number two, we are told to put the best construction on other people's motives. To put the best construction on other people's motives. Titus, we just read this. Speak evil of no one. That's putting the best construction on their motives, right? Avoid quarreling and be gentle and show courtesy. So we're called to put the best construction on other people's motives, to speak kindly and courteously. So, do you think universal health care would be an unmitigated disaster? Maybe that's what you think. That doesn't mean you care about nobody but yourself. Conversely, do you think universal health care is necessary for a compassionate society? And it may be the next best thing since sliced bread. That doesn't mean you want to enslave the population and take us all into worship, right? whatever idea or direction you think, there's sort of a caricature of why you do it or think it. And then there's the real reason. And you've got to get to the real reasons to let yourself get to a place where you can think about those in a kinder, gentler, more open way. When you impugn I've had this happen to me many times. Well, maybe not many, but a few. When you impugn the motives of somebody else, you put them in a position of having to argue for their character instead of trying to think about through a policy or a program or something like that. I mean, really, how can you have a discussion with somebody else who says, you just want to kill babies? Or you don't give a rat's behind about pregnant mothers? How can you have a conversation when somebody resorts to that? So one of the things we have to figure out is how not to bite on that hook. If we're having a conversation with somebody about something, we got to figure out how not to bite that hook. And see, you know, because somebody can do that. Somebody can say, we're not going to steer the conversation down this road. We're going to go back to what we're talking about instead of being all for or against the character. Okay? So, number three, we need to speak with compassion. We always need to speak with compassion about things. Paul tells the Colossians, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. Meekness, by the way, isn't wishy-washiness. Meekness is a willingness to reserve and hold back on your strength and power for the sake of the other person. That's what meekness is. Because we kind of, that in our day and age, we use meekness a little differently. We don't really value meekness in our current definition. So, compassionate. You got to think, be compassionate. Be compassionate for people who think differently than you, because there's two things. One is they have a backstory, right? They have all their own experiences that may have led them to their current positions. They have different set of education, different set of principles. You got to think compassionately about other people. And then you also have to think compassionately about the people that are affected by whatever you're talking about. You got to think compassionately about the people who are affected by whatever you're talking about. Let's talk about something real, run-of-the-mill, nobody has any strong opinions about it all. The Syrian refugee crisis. So how do we help the Syrians? Do we help these people? And how do we help these people? You have to think about that. The one thing you can't say is who cares. You might say there's one way, you might say there's a different way, you might say, you might talk about the role of the U.S. in the community of nations in the world. There's all sorts of things you can't talk about, but the one thing you can't do as a Christian is say, who cares? Because you know what we just read is that God's image and inscription are on them too. And so we cannot say, who cares? There's all sorts of policy things we can talk about, but the one thing we can't say about them is who cares. Compassion is the mark of a Christian. The next one, be wise and innocent. Be wise and innocent. A verse that we came across recently. Be wise as serpents and innocent as doves, says the Bible. So while we put the best construction on everything, Christians are well aware of the fallen nature of humanity. And so we don't walk around having to pretend that we think everybody in Washington or Tallahassee or wherever has the best of motives. And no one's out for their own personal power or gain or anything. You're all altruistic. You don't think that. To be a Christian is not a call to be a leader. So we have this balance, right? We've got to be compassionate. We've got to put the best construction on things. But we're also supposed to be wise about things. And as part of wisdom, I would like to offer you the opportunity to have some peace by being willing to admit that you don't know enough about a particular subject to have an educated opinion. I'm not saying you do or don't. I'm saying wise people are willing to admit when they don't know enough to have an educated opinion. Is there or is there not a refugee camp just outside of Syria that Syrians can get to and find safe haven and protection with UN troops? Does anyone know? I don't either. So maybe I don't know enough to start getting into a big heated argument. So that's wise. It's wise to know or to admit when you don't know. Of course, we already talked about the need to get educated. But the wise people are willing to admit they don't know enough to have a conversation about something. The last one, this is the last one right here. When you're going to talk, this is my suggestion. I heard this on a blog. I didn't hear it on a blog. I didn't have to read it. I heard it on a podcast from someone else. And his suggestion, and I thought it was a good one, was when you're talking about what's going on in our government, the best thing to do is to talk policy. I don't know if that's entirely true, because I think our leaders need to be trusted leaders, because we can't have all the information all the time. You have to just send people to the leadership post that you trust to make the right decision. But I heard somebody say talk policy, and I thought that was a good way to keep things in the zone where the emotions aren't getting overheated. Because the implementation, here's one thing, if you start talking policy, then you have to talk about who's affected by what, where, instead of just sort of general principles. You have to talk about how certain people are going to be affected by certain things, the way we decide to do certain things, and spend certain monies, and put certain priorities on different things. So, the kind of questions, instead of talking just about people, is this a good policy? Is this without regard to who's asking for it or implementing or whatever, is this a good thing to do? And why or why not? What are the positives? What are the negatives? What are the potential benefits? What are the dangers? What are the alternatives? And identify problems and stay solution-oriented. Spend as much time talking about solutions as you do pointing to the problems. There are some people who, if you come to them, there's some management books that say if an employee comes to you with a problem without a solution, you should just send them away. What you need is someone who's going to identify problems and offer solutions. And so and this is something you can ask somebody else, when they kind of get into complaining, just complaining about this and that, and say, what's your solution? That's pretty good, huh? You don't like the border wall? What's your solution? You think we should have a border wall? What does that solve? You didn't know there are tunnels. There are tunnels in San Diego. I'm just going to give you another piece of knowledge. I don't know what to do with it. In San Diego, there are tunnels with lighting, electricity, ventilation, and they are large enough to drive trucks through from Mexico. So they inside of a warehouse in Mexico, they dig a tunnel, they go underground, light, ventilation, proper supports, big enough to drive a pickup through, and then they come up in a warehouse in San Diego, 100 feet, 200 feet from the border. Is a border wall going to stop that? I'm just giving you thoughts. I'm not here to discuss the border wall. I will talk politics with you sometime, but not from the pulpit. It's not my job up here to be political. And that's the last thing I want to leave you with. Don't be afraid. As soon as you find yourself in a fear posture, you're moving in a way that is moving away from the core truth of the gospel, the center of what we believe about our lives, about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Here's what he said. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. And I would suggest to you the disciples were facing a lot of stuff that is much worse than any of us can reasonably be expected to face ever. And yet, Jesus' words are still peace. And so that's what I would say, that's what I would close up with here, is Christians need not fear. We can talk about it, we can work for whatever we think is right, we can try to be the best Christian citizen we can, but in the end, we have to stop the fear talk
Because who is ultimately running the show? Who's in charge of this thing called the earth? It's true that nations will rise and fall. It's happened before, and it will keep happening until Jesus comes home. But Christians, we need to stop and take a deep breath when we find that fear beginning to spin in our head. And listen, it doesn't matter who's president. There's somebody probably in this room who will have fear start spinning in their head based on who the president is. Because we are, you may not know it because we don't talk about it here, but we are a diverse group in this room, politically. So, when I tell you to talk compassionately about people who are different with you, I'm talking about your brothers and sisters in our own congregation, is in addition to everybody else. And if you'll place your life and soul in God's hands, you need not fear. If your first desire is to be a tool of Jesus' hands for the spreading of his love and redemption, then you don't have to fear because your first job is always secure. Your first job is always intact. So, what are you going to do with all these policies and procedures, elected officials? But I'm not here to tell you what to do. I'm just here to tell you that you are a Christian, and Christian citizens have a responsibility to be involved. Jesus got involved in the world for us, and we have a responsibility to get involved in the world for other people. My job is to encourage you to follow Christ. Being the incarnation of God's love, welcoming people into fellowship with God through Jesus, and giving your all for the sake of his kingdom, and never letting anything in your head rob your peace that comes from the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we are citizens of this country, a country conceived of in liberty, which seems to reflect the way that you treat humanity. And with the privilege of being in this country comes the responsibility of having power, every single one of us, the power of voice and vote. So teach us, Father, how to be good citizens of this country. How to speak with others. How to let our minds be open with compassion for other people's thoughts and experiences. Teach us how to be good citizens of this nation. So, a couple, three things here to think about while we take a short break. And you can bring your offerings and prayer cards forward. When does politics give rise to fear in me? Number two, have I exposed myself to other points of view? And number three, of the things that I can offer about, have I disconnected from my responsibility as a citizen? And for instance, did you vote? I'm not asking for a show of hands, but did you vote? That would be the lowest level of connecting with your responsibilities as a citizen. So we'll reconvene in about 4 or 5 minutes for the service of Holy Communion. Thank you.
let's stand as we celebrate the service of Holy Communion. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is able and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve to be separated from you forever. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a fellow believer, I announce forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Holy Spirit, one holy Christ.
with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
Let us pray for the people of God and all people everywhere according to their needs.
We join together to pray for our gracious Heavenly
Father. Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity and even the encouragement to pray to you, to bring the stuff of our lives to you, and your promise to heal us and love. And so we bring to you these requests today. We want to pray for Kathy, who is going in for lung surgery tomorrow. We ask you to hold her hand. We ask you to give her peace and her family. We ask you to guide the entire medical team to operate in ways that will bring healing. Father, bring her the complete peace. We also want to continue our prayers for complete healing for Mike and Leanne's grandson, Luke, from his brain tumor. We always continue our prayer for our servicemen and women overseas, for people undergoing persecution, for their release, and also for repentance in the hearts of their persecutors, and for our brothers and sisters to even have, through the miracle of the Holy Spirit, a testimony of love to those who are persecuted. We pray for our mission and ministry workers, Tom and Marilyn, Wayne and Grace, Mike and Leanne, and David and Ruth. We continue our prayers for health and healing for Brad Tibbs and Donna Olmsted and John Bernhau. We also continue our prayers on behalf of Andrea Reichart, and we thank you for the success of her treatment, and we pray for complete healing and remission. We continue our prayers for Barbara and Ralph and their family members, as Barbara and Ralph suffer from dementia. We also want to ask you to heal Frank's headaches. We want to pray for mission organizations we support, for Wycliffe and Crew, and Lutheran Bible translators. I want to pray for a family whose the wife and mother has passed away too soon from cancer. We ask you to give peace to the Wycliffe family. We want to pray for people who don't know that you have made this right between you and us, through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray for all spreading the news of Jesus, and we pray that you would use us to do that, and don't let us rest, Lord. Tickle us, or prod us, or poke us, or whatever. Don't let us rest on the name of Christ, but let us be part of the expansion of your kingdom. We ask that in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, he passed it to his disciples, and said, drink of this, all of you, this cup is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as we drink it, in remembrance of me. And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us.
Approach the altar and either dip your bread in the cup toward the center, or if you prefer to take a sip,
We have, take a sip from one of the gold-colored cups on the outside there. We do not decide who comes to communion. We proclaim what it is and offer the meal of Jesus Christ, his body and blood for our forgiveness to all who would like to receive this morning. Welcome to the Lord's table. Let's pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have come to us today in word and in sacrament. You have refreshed our spirits through your word and connected us to you and to one another through this holy meal. We ask that your spirit would do your work in our spirits so that we could be more and more your people, including your people as citizens of a country where we have that power and voice and vote. Father, teach us to be good citizens of our country and good citizens of your kingdom. We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. A couple of announcements as we close. Military Bible Sticks.
Heard it. There's some literature available this month on the hall table. This gives you information that you can pass along to your neighbors and friends about what the Bible Stick program is. And in case you haven't seen it, it's very interesting that it's so small. Very small with earbuds. So the whole thing fits in someone's pocket. These are provided to people who are deployed on duty. Usually through the chaplains, as I understand it, so you know that it's going to the right people. If you decide to make a donation through Journey of Life, be sure that you mark on the check that it's 4, 5, or 6, so that Karen can put it in the right place. Also, you might, in giving this to neighbors and friends and getting them interested in making donations, there are $25 each for one of these Bible sticks to send overseas. And you might want to have something that has the mailing address Journey of Life on, because this is just information about the Bible Sticks, but make sure that if someone else is going to make a donation, they know where to send it.
Thank you, Ann. They can also do it online. Just go to journeyoflife.org and you'll see the link. I think as of right now, including
a check that you haven't seen yet, because I know you've always got that. I think that we have $450 so far.
Wow. I don't know if you mentioned it before, but I also wondered if we should ask everyone to look around and see if they come up with possibly a place where you can have a fundraiser and get out kind of in the public at some point and show them what the body's gifts are, maybe get some more donations that way. And other organizations, if you belong to some civic organization or even a military organization, you might ask them about making donations. I'm wondering, though, if you go to military veterans organizations, they won't want to make the donation themselves, like to Bible sticks, but if they can make it through us, it would work better for one solid donation.
And Paula Edwards, who was here last week, she's a retired military, and she spoke about the Bible sticks and how she's seen them in the instruments. So it's really cool for
you. Okay. First and foremost, I want to thank Pastor for that sermon today, because, sorry about that, sir, but, you know, as I said, hey, listen, this isn't just about our political life. There was many, many things in that sermon this morning that we can carry over into our daily life, and I really thought it was very refreshing for me to hear some of this, just in case you don't know. But anyway, again, we have a great big amount of Panera Bread in the back, okay? I know I say this every Sunday, but what we don't take for ourselves to give, and to give maybe some to a needy family, and it seems like I'm seeing more needy, not maybe on the street corners these days, but in my daily conversations with people. So feel free to take a couple loaves and give it to someone that you know and tell them, this is Panera Bread and it's from Journey of Life and we just want to help you out a little bit. I don't see anything wrong with that at all. And if anybody wants to help us pick up the Panera Bread, you just need to let me know about it. We have two or three of us that make the journey every Saturday night into Panera at 9:15, and believe me, It's a journey because those bread bags are big and they're heavy. So we have.
They help you out, right? If you need it.
Oh yes. One young lady, I said, I'm sorry, but I won't carry that. And this person who had to be in their 20s, a woman, just took this huge, great big bag and threw it over her shoulder, and out she went to where James was. And if you would be so kind, some of the regulars, to save your unsoiled grocery bags and bring them in. I, for some reason, am running low on grocery bags or extra bags of some kind. If you are trying to get brown bags, fold them up and bring them in. We can use them to give to people. Okay.
Thank you. I'm sure you'll get an abundant harvest of shopping bags. Well, anybody who doesn't have
Loads. We got a white hamper in there that is absolutely empty right now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else? Okay, one more thing, if you would click for me. Potluck brunch is next Sunday, July 9th, so bring something and let's eat together. And it's been working fine, right? I mean, I haven't been kind of keeping track, but we quit trying to do, like, letter assignments or anything. Just bring a main dish, side dish, or salad.
We only failed once, you know, and had four plates of deviled eggs and one box of chicken.
Anything else? Let's stand up and sing our closing song.
Thank you.
bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.